So, understanding the infrastructure, understanding the architecture of a supercomputer comes under computer engineering. I understand only the architecture of a personal computer and to some extent server. I understand only the architecture, but if you ask me to develop a chip for it, I can't do that. All these things comes under what? Yes, computer engineering. And the next one is called as information system. Yes, this is my strong point. Information system. Study of hardware and software. I can tell you what this device is doing and how it is doing. How a chip works. Okay. How this memory works. What is the use of this motherboard? What exactly motherboard is doing? That is study of hardware. And software, I can do almost any type of software. I mean to say almost any type of program I can write. So what I'm saying is, the study of hardware and software, the application part of hardware and software can be learned in an information system. Information system is all about collection of the data, storing of the data, processing of the data, and dissemination of data. Why I said dissemination? Distribute is the word for hardware. I have chocolates with me. I am distributing chocolates. Okay? But I have data with me. Is this data tangible? No. So we are using the word dissemination. I have written over here distribute only so that you can understand it. But I am telling you the right word. Dissemination of the data. The data should go to the right person. The data should go to the right person. I have a paper where I have written all my earnings throughout the year. I intend that this data should go to my chartered accountant. But if this data directly goes to an income tax officer, are meri to band baj jayegi na? Am I right or wrong? Yes or no? So information technology is all about collection of the information, storing of the information, processing of the information, and sending the information to the right person. It is about the operation, management, and decision making. When the right data is with me, I can take decision. Right or wrong? I have no data and I'm asked to take decision, I won't be able to do it. I don't have timetable, and tomorrow you are asking me, sir, what time do your lecture starts? How can I give you the answer? I don't have the timetable. Understanding? So I should have the data so that I can make right decision. And information system is also about people who are interacting with the computing system. That's why I give you that chart. Remember that chart of computer system? On the right hand side, it was liveware. Starting with end user, junior programmer, senior programmer, system analyst, system tester, and project manager. These are nothing but the people who are interacting with what? Computer systems. Understanding? Okay.
Gracias.
Finish.
మూర్చాచా.
We are now moving to acha. We have seen three sub disciplines, starting with computer science, computer engineering and information systems. We are now moving to the next type sub discipline, and it is called as information technology, information system. Information system is all about the hardware and software, but when we talk about information technology, it is obviously about hardware because it is the technology. Okay, information technology, I would say, is a part of information system. Information system, data and the technology are both encapsulated within each other. But when I talk about information technology, it's only the hardware which is supporting the system. Okay, so let's talk about information technology. It is the application of computers. It's the system where you can store the data, retrieve the data, transmit the data, manipulate the data. So all these things are done with the help of what? Hardware, na? Storing the data, hard disk, any other secondary storage devices, retrieving the data, output devices, transmitting the data, some physical wires, or if it is a wireless technology, at least we will be requiring a transmitter and a receptor, na? That is hardware. And manipulating the data, you require processors for it. All these things comes under computer hardware. So it is the study, design and development of a computer based information system. So we are having an information system where we can study how exactly the data is stored, how exactly it is processed, design a system, develop a system and then implementing it so that the end user can use it. That is nothing but the information technology. And the last one is software engineering. If engineering was everything, if engineering was everything for hardware, then software engineering is everything about software. What is software engineering basically? It is designing, developing and maintaining a software. And I told you in my very first lecture what is software. Software is collection of programs, and program is a logical collection of commands. So when you are going for software engineering, one should understand basic instructions and their use or their applications. Once you know what each and every command is doing, then only you can construct them, you can arrange them logically to get a program. And this collection of program is called as software. See, when you are cooking, you need to know, na, what is the nature of every spice. Okay, haldi kya karta hai, mirchi kya karta hai, namak kya karta hai, jeera, rai, sab ye sab kya karta hai tumko malum hona chahiye na. Are namak ke jagah pe mirchi dal diya to kya hoega? Are you understanding? I need not ask them, are you understanding? They understand better than us. Acha, please, please. Okay. In the same way, in software engineering, a programmer or a software developer should understand the need, the importance and the working of each and every command. These commands are arranged properly to form a program, and that's how a software is created. So software engineering basically is a designing, development of a software. And after developing a software, his responsibility is not ending. You require to maintain that software very well. Then it all starts with writing programs. You should write a program. You should write the sequence of commands. Then only you'll be able to create a software. Then it is all the technical aspects of software. It is all the technical aspects of software. Means one needs to understand the format of input. One needs to understand what are variables, how they will be used. One needs to understand how arithmetical operators work, how relational operators work, how logical operators work. One needs to know what are the various functions available in that particular programming language. How can we use these functions so that our process can be automated? All these are the technical aspects of software system. And ultimately, software engineering helps the management in scheduling and budgeting. If schedules are required, na? If I want to convert a manual system into a computerized one, I cannot give him unlimited time to do. It has to be done in a stipulated period of time, and that refers to preparation of timetable. Technically, it is called as scheduling. And how much money we should spend on development of a software, there are certain constraints about it. If your software development expenses are more than your capital itself, your business will close down before it starts. So one needs to understand the concept of budgeting. How much budget can be allocated for this particular process? All these things comes under software engineering. So all in all, I discussed 5 sub-disciplines, starting from computer science, computer engineering, information systems, information technology, and software engineering. Getting it? Okay, we are now moving to the next one, and that is called as, what is server and what are its types? To understand what is a server, one needs to understand what are the different types of computers. What are the different types of computers? I'll start with very basics. Computers can be divided on 2 bases. One is called as the technical aspects. That is the technology that is being used. If I start talking about technology that is being used, you won't understand it. It's better not to talk. It's called as analog computer, digital computers, hybrid computers. There are some computers. But I can surely explain you the concept where computers are bifurcated on the basis of memory and size. Okay. A basic type of computer is called as personal computer. It is called as what? Personal computer. It's also called as a very basic computer, which you see at your home is nothing but a personal computer. It is having a very basic configuration, like there would be a motherboard, there would be a normal processor, Intel dual core 2, okay, i3, i5, i7, RAM at around 2 GB, one monitor, one keyboard, one mouse, maybe some speakers attached to it, hard disk, some DVD drive, USB connections. These are some basic things, webcam if required, and so on. That's a personal computer. Okay. Now, here you can do normal processing. Whatever you do in your everyday life with the help of computers, that can be done on that particular computer. But whenever 100 people are accessing one computer, that point of time, your personal computer will not be able to process the data of 100 requests. Under that circumstances, you require something called as mini computer. Just now, I discussed about micro computer. Now, I am talking about a mini computer. A mini computer is bigger in size. You must have seen a Doberman dog or an Alsatian dog. It is of this big size. Nice, big, fat. Okay. That is the size of the server. And in terms of dogs, that Pomeranian dog, show dog, wow, wow, small one. That is nothing but a personal computer. It would be of this size. So now I'm talking about a mini computer. A mini computer is bigger in size. It is having more storage space. Normal personal computers is having one hard disk. Okay. It could be 500 GB, 320 GB, 1 TB. But a server is having, or I mean to say, the mini computer is having rack, entire rack of hard disks. So obviously, the storage space is more. In a normal computer, you will find two slots for fitting in RAM chip. But in a mini computer, also called as a server, there are more number of slots. You can add more number of RAM chips. The processor that we are talking about belongs to altogether a different generation. When you are buying a PC, you will be thinking about Intel, AMD, i3, i5, i7, dual core, Core 2 Duo, and so on. But a person who purchases a mini computer, obviously, that means a server, he is not thinking about all these processors. He thinks about Intel Xeon. You must have seen ad in papers, X-E-O-N. It is a processor for bigger machines, for mini computers, also called as servers. Then there is a bigger type than a mini computer, and that is called as a mainframe computers. These mainframe computers are used to process thousands of processes together. Microcomputer is a lone machine, is a sole machine. Server or mini computer can support 100 microcomputers, whereas a mainframe computer can support thousands of microcomputers. Indian Railway Reservation Systems works on mainframe. You must be knowing this, that if you want to book a ticket from Chennai to Coimbatore and you are somewhere in Delhi, you can do that. Staying in Delhi, going at the counter in Delhi, you can book a ticket from Chennai to Coimbatore. Are, where is Delhi? Where is Chennai? Where is Coimbatore? Delhi never falls in between Chennai and Coimbatore. But still, you can book a ticket. Because everything is online. Just think, all over India, how many stations are there where there is computerization reservation facility available. At one station, there are so many counters. And so many people are standing in a queue, but all their requests are being processed by only one single computer. That's the mainframe, situated in a suburb of Mumbai called as Mumbai Central. There this mainframe computer is situated, which handles everything. Okay, so it is more powerful. And last but not the least is a supercomputer. It's nothing but a supercomputer. No commercial organization in this world is owning a supercomputer. It is only owned by government. So obviously, it will be exclusively used for government purpose, like weather forecasting. Okay? It will be used in defense. Gone are those days where there was traditional warfare. Tanks, guns, airplanes, bullets, bombs. Gone are those days. Today, no one can invade India. No one will think about a war with India. Do you know why? Sorry? Are missile is not important. Because of the population. And Indian population is very patriotic. Not like other countries. Suppose tomorrow there is a war. Okay, and if some another country is invading India, the army is not able to stop them. Okay, here in India, in different junctions, there will be a song played, Mere Desh Ki Dharti, and people will forget about everything, whatever they get, whatever device, I am ready to fight for my motherland. Ye to jazba hai apne yahan ka, koi apne ko attack nahi kar sakta hai. Other countries, other countries people, Americans for example, they fear for their life. That's why they are inventing new weapons. I was seeing a documentary called as Future Weapons, where that gun would turn like this. Why? Because if there is a wall and if there is a enemy over there, how can we look there and shoot? If he'll shoot directly, it will go in my head. They are fearing for their life. Are you see our Indians? They don't fear for anyone. Sanjay Dutt, hey, kon hai re, jaake tha. We don't have fear. We are ready to die. Please calm down. I have something more to say. So in traditional war, no country can beat us. 1971 war. I don't remember the date. India-Pakistan. Okay. That time, Chennai was very far away, but Mumbai is nearer to Pakistan. Yeah, Mumbai is nearer to Pakistan. I know geography very well. That time, obviously I was not born that time, but my parents used to tell me, at night you cannot put on the light. And if it is really very important to put on the light, you should be having black paper on windows. Because that time, Pakistani flights were used to come in the Indian airfield. And if they see light, it was assumed that it is a, populated area. And they used to drop bomb over there. So full blackout. At the same time, Indian airplanes were also going over there. Okay, but today it is not so. What will you do today? Today you will take an air flight and you will see down. Hey, look, Karachi, drop the bomb. Are today it will be a nuclear warfare. And in this nuclear warfare, what will happen is, okay, we have said that we won't be the first country to use nuclear weapons. But other countries, you never know. Okay, they will press one button and first to be destroyed in India will be Mumbai. It's the financial capital. If Mumbai is gone, India will be paralyzed. Okay, then our super cool Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh. He will say one killer dialogue. Atta Maji Satakli. And then he will press one button and then that entire enemy country will be gone. And those people who are handling missiles over there, they won't be in that country. They will be in some another country. And on their screen, there will be a message, game over. Why I am telling you all these things is, you need to understand the classification of four different types of computers based on size and memory. The microcomputer, which is there at your residence. The mini computer, which supports hundreds of microcomputer, and that exactly is nothing but the server, which is the topic to be discussed. And just for your general knowledge, there are bigger and better computers, mainframe and a supercomputer. Okay? Now we are discussing about the server. Now what is a server? Server is a computer bigger in size, faster in processing, more in storage and higher memory. Okay, and this particular server is attached to many other microcomputers called as node or terminal. This server will accept the requests from the microcomputers, it will process the data and it will give the output to those microcomputers. No one can sit on the server and give command to the server directly, apart from the server administrator. Normal user cannot directly access the server. They can access the server, but it is through their nodes. So the work of the server is to process the data. It has got centralized data processing. All the resources that you have, the data resources, the file resources, the software resources, the hardware resources, all resources resides on the server. Any user, if they want to access this resource, they have to share it, they have to borrow it from the server. So I would say here there is concentration of resources. The server means centralized processing of data and the storage of all different types of resources. That is how a server has been constructed. So actually speaking, server is hardware and software that a server serves to the entire network. Okay, so any user on the network, if he wants to access something, server will give. If he wants some hardware, server will give. If he wants some software, server will give. If he wants some data, server will give. And it is a specialized computer for processing of the data. And all the data resources is also stored centrally on the server. So we can say it's a major storage area for all the data available on a network. That's nothing but a server. This particular server is connected with several nodes, with several computers. In layman's language, a normal microcomputer, a normal personal computer is connected to the server. The users give their request on the node, which is forwarded to the server. Server will do the processing and the output is transferred to the node where the user can see it. That's how our server concept is working. Now let's try to understand what are the different types of server. The first type of server is called as file server. As the name is indicating, file server stores all the files required by different types of users. For example, Satya is having his biodata, his resume. But that resume will be stored on the server. Okay. Ram Prakash had stored some communication with someone. That will be stored on the server. Don't worry, it will be protected, but it is stored on the server. Then Janani might be having photograph of someone. That will be stored on the server. Okay, so server stores all the files, photo file, text file, audio file, video file, any file you have that will be stored on the server. Next one is called as the print server. A print server is that server which will hold all the data or the files which are required to be printed. Are you understanding? See, if everyone starts giving command to the printer and if all the data starts flowing directly inside the printer, the printer's memory will hang. A printer is a small device with limited memory, understanding? Yes. It cannot accept command from each and every computer. So what exactly happens is, whatever data, whatever documents you want to print, those documents will come to the server. And this server will be connected to a printer. Okay, so if you are giving 100 commands at a time, no problem. That server will maintain a queue. And then the server will give only one printout command to that printer. And printer at a point of time will be having only one command. It will be printing. I'm talking about a dot matrix printer. Once that is over, the server will give the next document. So that particular printer will never feel the pressure. Oh, I have to print 1000 documents. All these things will be with the server. Printer, one document at a time. That is called as print server. Next one is called as the network server. I won't tolerate this nonsense. Huh? If you're not interested, you can leave. And who was that? If you are feeling sleepy, please don't come. And after coming, if you are feeling sleepy, you can leave. I don't mind. Just tell me, sir, I am not interested. I am feeling sleepy. Leave the class. I was talking about the network server. Now, what exactly is this network server? Network server is a server on the network. That means it will be connected with n number of nodes, All the nodes will be firing their commands to the server, and this server will be processing the data of the various users on different nodes. That is called as a network server. One more concept or one more responsibility of the network server is to handle the data traffic in the network. See, it is not necessary that every time I have to process some data. I need to give some data to Mr. Ram Prakash. I am on one node, he is on some another node. I am sending the data. Satya is sending data to someone. She is sending data to her. He is sending data to him. And n number of people are sending data to n number of people. Don't you think there will be a traffic? This traffic is handled. This traffic is eased off with the help of the network server. Then the database server. Now, what exactly is this database server? Now, whenever you came for admission, you were given a form to fill up this inquiry form or fill up the admission form. What you did? You wrote your name, your number, your address, then your qualification. That is 12th pass or CPT pass, in which class you were studying before, this, that, your college name, right? All this data is being maintained on a software. And that software, I would say, that system is called as a database management systems, which we will be studying in this chapter only. Okay. So that database is being stored on a specialized computer that is called as the database server. Then we have the application server. Obviously, there are n number of applications that we use. We use paintbrush for painting, we use Word for drafting letters, we use PowerPoint for presentations. In the same way, in corporates, for n number of things, we have different types of applications. All these applications are being stored in a common server, and that server is called as application server. Then we have the web server. Web server handles the internet. Web server will show you or will take you to those websites that you want to see. Or in other words, in simple terms, I can say all those websites that you are seeing on your terminal actually resides in some web server. And last but not the least is called as mail server. You have your mail IDs. In that mail ID, in that mail, you have n number of mails, and it has to be stored somewhere, na? And that is nothing but mail server. When you log on to your mail, that mail has to be opened before you. It is the responsibility of the mail server. Understanding?
Yes, sir.
That was nothing but server and its type. So before we start with computer architecture,
Thank you.
I
Shall we start? We are now beginning with the most technical aspect of computing, and that is understanding a computer architecture. Shall we start? Now, what is a computer architecture? Whenever we learn something new, actually speaking, we are learning science. We are learning about mountains, we are learning about rivers and this and that. That comes in geography. Science is further divided into physics, chemistry, and biology. So whenever we are talking about the computer architecture, it is nothing but we are learning the science of it. Okay? So computer architecture is the art and science of understanding how the various hardware components are related with each other. One electronic component cannot do anything. Hard disk is saving the data, but how it receives the data? That's a big question mark. Memory will be storing the data temporarily so that a user can interact with that particular memory cells. But how exactly does that? Processor manipulates the data. Then who carries the data between processor, memory, and hard disk? How the data is taken to the output devices? How the data is received? We know that input devices accept the data. We know output devices shows the data. We know hard disk stores the data. We know memory holds the data temporarily. We know that processor manipulates the data. But if I ask you a question, how? We will not be able to answer a single question. How input is taken? We don't know. How output is given? We don't know. How the data is stored inside a hard disk? We don't know. How a RAM chip holds the data? We don't know. And when a processor is processing the data, what exactly it is doing? We don't know. Such questions are answered by computer architecture. Nacha. We are not going into the details of this, how it is. That is all part of computer engineering, and we are not doing engineering over here. But at least we need to understand this thing. All these things, understanding all these things, comes under computer architecture. Interconnection of computer components, of hardware components, is very important. There are n number of hardware components inside a computing system. They needed to be connected to each other very well. Take into consideration a car. The engine of the car has to be connected properly to the wheels. If the wheels are not connected to the engine, what is the use? Will the car move? The steering wheel has to be connected to the wheels. The petrol tank has to supply proper petrol to the engine, and so on. We understand the use of it, but how they are connected, how they are interconnected, that is all automobile engineering. We don't understand that. We don't know that. In the same way, there are various components inside a computing system. How they are connected with each other, who plays what role, and when, all such things are understood in a computer architecture. I said, it is the relation between the parts. It is when, how, what component will be working. It is also said that computer architecture is the interface between hardware and software. We are saying a very blind statement. Software makes the hardware run. But how? Software itself is intangible. How it is making the hardware work? I can simplify this question. How can a soul make a person alive? No one can answer this question. Soul itself is intangible. We cannot see it. We cannot feel it. Then why people are alive when we have soul inside it? I don't know. In the same way, how that software makes the hardware work, we don't know. And this actual work is known in computer architecture. So all in all, I can say it is the conceptual design, or it is understanding of the fundamental structure of a computing system. Okay? It is also called as the ISA. It is the instruction set architecture. Okay? So we can say there are some categories of computer architecture. We can divide it into different functions depending upon the work. The first one, the first subcategory of a computer architecture is called as ISA. It is instruction set architecture. Here we will be studying what exactly the chip does. What is a chip? It could be any type of chip. The most important in that is a processor chip. What exactly is the role of a processor chip? Then, how exactly we will be programming a chip? I said, na, ROM. ROM has got the booting process. Or somebody must have programmed that ROM chip, na? So programming a chip is a very difficult thing. See, writing general programs and converting a manual system into a computerized one is quite fine. But this itself is a computer system working. So programming a chip is nothing but a part of ISA. When we give instructions to the computer, computer gives output to us and we are very happy about it. But no one ever thinks ki how computer is understanding our instructions. We are giving in our instructions in the form of software. So how a hardware understands? If I say to this mic, hey, switch off. It won't. Because it is not understanding what I am saying. But if I give the same instruction to computer, it will shut off artificial intelligence. Forget about these big things. If I am typing something that is nothing but what? Intangible, na? Using these intangible things, I am able to control a tangible thing. And that is nothing but how computer understands the things. Computer architecture is an abstract model. What exactly is this abstract model? Those students who are studying architect, okay, they don't construct buildings, but they design a building, the construction of a building. Okay, what do you think? They immediately design a building. They are first asked to learn a model. Okay, model will tell you how many pillars you should add. What should be the weight, or how much weight can be exerted on a pillar? How many pillars are required? How much slabs can you construct? What should be the size of the wall? All these things is nothing but training for building something. In the same way, this computer architecture is an abstract model which helps you to understand how a computer works. Okay, so I would say that it is a sort of a bridge. It is sort of a bridge between hardware and software. Okay, it's the interface between hardware and software. There are two types of instruction set architecture. It is CISC and RISC. CISC stands for Complex Instruction Set Computing, where you'll be having a single chip which performs n number of complex instructions, and it is a very costly architecture. On the other hand, we have RISC, R-I-S-C. It is Reduced Instruction Set Computer. It works on a technology where you have more number of chip but performing simple applications, simple logical programs. So this is a cheaper one, and the computer that we have today is actually a RISC. Which we are using is a RISC. That is nothing but the industry standard, instructions set architecture. Then the second subcategory of a computer architecture is the micro architecture. It tells us about the computer organization. if computer architecture is all about machine level programming, it is all about the chip, it is all about the processor, but micro architecture is about the parts that we understand better. It will be about the input devices, it will be about the output devices, it will be about the storage devices, it will describe all the parts, it will describe how they are interconnected with each other. So a normal hardware engineer has to learn micro architecture. Means what? When he brings all the components, when he buys all the parts from the market, he needs to know how to connect this part to a motherboard, how the motherboard will get supply, how hard disk is connected, how RAM is connected, how processor is connected, how CD-ROM drives, all these things are connected, how monitor and keyboard will be connected. All these things comes under what? Micro architecture. It's all about the interconnection of parts with each other so that a computing system can work efficiently. It's also the interoperation. When we save a file, what happens? What do you mean by saving a file? Saving a file technically means transferring the contents of the RAM inside the hard disk. Opening a file means the contents of the hard disk are transferred in RAM. Understanding such things comes under micro architecture. And last is system design. All the other remaining hardware of the computer comes under system design. It is about the computer bus. Now I'll tell you what is a computer bus. You must have seen set of wires which is been connecting hard disk and the motherboard. Have you seen that? If you look at it in this way, it's very fat. But if you turn in this way, it's very thin. The width is more. Okay, but the thickness is very less. These wires actually transfer data from one device to another device. That is called as a computer bus. Transfer of the data. Now, if you have seen a motherboard, there are some lines on motherboard. Okay, golden color lines. These lines actually transmit the data. See, whenever you are saving a file, I said saving a file means transferring the data from RAM to hard disk. But is RAM connected to hard disk? Huh? Is RAM connected to hard disk? No. RAM is connected to motherboard. Hard disk is connected to motherboard. That means whenever you are transferring the data from this RAM to hard disk, it has to travel through motherboard. And the data transfers through integrated circuits. It is also called as what? Computer bus. Then we have memory controllers. I know this is a bit technical, but can't help. And in this, I cannot put an example. It's hardware. It has to be understood in the same way. Now, memory controllers. What are these memory controllers? See, memory is limited. Do you understand it? If all data starts flowing inside the memory will be full, it will start overflowing and the computer will hang. We don't want that. So there are some chips which controls how much data is going inside the memory and how much data is going outside the memory. That is called as memory controllers. Then we have direct memory access. Direct memory access means many applications or many hardware needs to have some memory from the processor. So they are directly connecting to the processor. They are directly connecting to the memory. That is called as direct memory access. And the last one in this is called as multiprocessing. What's this multiprocessing? Multiprocessing means multiple processes are being processed at a given point of time. We all know that a processor works with only one process. But today, there are dual core processors. There are, yes, quad core processors. There are hexa core processors. Am I right or wrong? If you talk about a supercomputer, there are hundreds of processors working simultaneously. So don't you think it will be multiprocessing? Okay, so all about multiprocessing, all these things are studied in a system design. Getting this or not? That is nothing but the computer architecture.
Thank you.